thanks for coming. I should first of all acknowledge that we're meeting on the traditional country of the Wabakal and Warramai people, and all the respect that the school and the city has for what that means. I should also thank our sponsors, which include the Hunter Development Corporation, Eagle, BPA Architecture, Nevisa, the Lockup, Marline Building Services Engineers, and Grapplesoft. It's a pleasure to introduce Annabel, who I've met for the first time today, but have known her work for a very long time. She employs some of my closest friends, and some of the most interesting architecture in New South Wales and Australia is coming out of their office. Disproportionately large amount of work for what is actually a very small office, so highly productive. I can see she's uncomfortable with the instructions, I'll let her introduce herself, but it's fantastic to have her here and fantastic for us. So thanks for having me.
Okay, so recently our practice celebrated 20 years. And we did this with a publication of a retrospective of our work. So perhaps it's fitting that I've called this talk today, Lahz and I, a work in progress. So self-published, self-curated, the book is part of a celebration. It's part celebration, part contemplation of the future. It's provided us with an opportunity to pause, reflect on our work, think about our recurring themes, as well as which projects really matter to us. And throughout this process, we also worked with an illustrator, Rowan Kane, who we gave themes from a variety of our buildings and allowed him to then reinterpret them, but only using the building plans and drawings themselves. So they'll be peppered throughout the presentation. So what I've done, and I haven't given this talk before, so it's kind of like a drop. But having written this book, my partner Andrew wrote a terrific essay called Something, which I've used to structure the talk. So I'm going to be moving in and out of reading bits and pieces of his essay. So we'll see if that works or not. So there we are, it's a bit dark. But that's at our book launch. So that's a whole bunch of past and present members of Lahz Nimmo, and I think if you look closely, you can certainly see in the front row two attention seekers, and then a couple just lurking in the back there. So now, after 20 years, the practice has evolved into something of design collaborative, in which many hands can be seen to be at work and no design attributed to a single person. This is a deliberate approach. We were never comfortable with the image of the lone architect as genius and hero. We see architecture as a much more complex and one person's single-minded obsession. Even in the early stages, the decision to merge the Lahz and the Nimmo was about de-emphasising the individual. This is very important to understanding how our studio works. In addition to Andrew and myself, we now have two partners, Brad Cogger and Hugo Cottier, who have been with the practice now for over half its life. And I should also give a special mention to Andrew LeBron, who used to be a partner here and was also with us for a very significant amount of the time. All have had influence on the work that we produce. In that time, each has been influenced by the design culture of the practice established before they arrived, and in turn have pushed the practice towards confident maturity that I think is reflected in the broad range of projects, types and scales that we now work with. By necessity, architecture is a collaborative art. Many people are involved in the creative process and making of architecture, and it's many competing and often contradictory requirements. While the architect sets and leads the creative direction, others also contribute to the craft and outcome. The process is long and at times painfully slow, not just painful. Architecture usually involves spending large sums of someone else's money, and although seen as one of the arts, it is not created for its own sake. It must work if it's to be a success. So we really see the architect as more of a facilitator, though not a passive one. Architecture should never be designed by committee, and it requires a clear initial something to drive its direction. So how did our practice come about? I always like to say this is how we didn't come about. And I don't think very many practices come about through winning glamorous international design competitions. This has certainly not been our, certainly hasn't been our experience, and we've built our practice very slowly over a 21-year period, starting with very modest commissions and building to larger, more complex ones. So to understand a little bit about how our office evolved, I'm just going to backtrack to talk about Andrew and my formative years, and I suppose some early influences, the student years. That's right. Your teachers can influence you. So the early work for us has very strong roots in our upbringing at Queensland. And both Andrew and I were at the University of Queensland, and under the leadership of people like Michael Kennedy, Britt Anderson, Peter O'Gorman, Max Horner, Don Watson, probably people that we haven't really heard of, but we were given a very sound grounding in the sensory aspect of architecture, and we were encouraged to look beyond the limiting form follows function mantra, or the seductive obsession with the image, which is still with us today. So in 1984, I was fortunate enough to go to London to the Architecture Association, where I studied under Peter Wilson, Bowles Wilson. Back then, Peter had, I think, just done the interior of his apartment, so he was still in the infant stages of his practice. And for me, his unit was incredibly important. It introduced me to architectural things like poetry, the figurative, the narrative, tectonic, their role in architecture. And he also reminded us constantly that architecture is a small series of moments, placing it firmly in the world of experience. He also taught the idea that play was a critical part of the cultural environment. So, whilst I was over there being very serious, Andrew, my partner, was studying, and in the early 80s, in parallel with his studies, he was involved in fact founded a Brisbane absurdist theatre group called the Fluter Troupe, mostly comprising of architects. This group wrote, designed and performed their own material, much of which created little worlds of nonsense, each with their own internal logic and occupied by vaguely recognisable characters from the world of love. Lower, right, left, upper, right. So it's not really that surprising that his thesis was on the architecture of nonsense, whilst mine focused on the more serious aspect of what architecture was, art, craft, or aesthetic of everyday life. Andrew's apprenticeship at TZG's been a bit obliterated there by the quality of the image, but the idea of this is that serving an apprenticeship, I think, is pretty key to establishing a practice. It provides you not only with experience and a knowledge base, but also the appreciation of actually how a practice runs. So Andrew spent his internship with Tompkins at Leica, and I was with Lawrence Neal. Gabby, you all know. It's a fabulous time, script times. So, I'm just going to whiz through a timeline, not really to dwell on things, but really just to give you a bit of an overview of, I suppose, the journey we've been on, and then I'm going to go through some recurring themes. So this is really just setting a bit of a stage for that. Right, so upholding the age-old tradition, our practice was launched by our own modest terrace house addition, as well as the advent of children. We're now 24. In those days, childcare fees being so exorbitant and having twins, architectural salaries being so low, one parent may as well stay home and start a practice. There was nothing to lose. And in this case, it was my partner, Andrew. So like a lot of young practices, we did residential work in our early years. However, having worked with people like Lawrence and Peter Tonkin, our real interest was in public work, which we pursued from a very early on in the practice. So that led to some very early public commissions, which were, I suppose, to clients represented not that much risk to give to an emerging practice. They were very temporary, ephemeral wayfinding overlays. The first for the Royal Easter Show at Homebush, and then the second for the Sydney Olympic Games. Both of those were paid shortlisted competitions. Then came, I suppose, much more of a prestigious and permanent commission, which was for the St James Station environs within Hull Park. Having said we didn't do a lot of houses, we did do one significant house at Casuarina Beach, which is actually one of the very few freestanding houses we've done, and one which at that time received a lot of publicity, which was very good for our fledgling practice. So following on really from St James, we received a commission in Centennial Park to do a series of amenities. And again, that was through a paid shortlisted competition. Despite being now 10 years old, it's still, it's gonna haunt me actually till I retire, but it's still is in the top 10 list of dummies globally each year. And I think has actually probably responsible for sparking a bit of a revolution in amenity design. Now, so many architects through councils have done an amazing series of different amenities. Shift. Right. Warragamba. Okay, Warragamba Dam. That was a very slow burn of a project. This was over 7 years in the making. It was a step up in scale for us. It was designed and documented not once, but twice. So there's a bit of a story there. But it's still a very much a favourite building of ours and probably one of the most dramatic sites that we've ever built on. So as fast as Warragamba was slow, this is Armoury Wharf that was built in an extraordinarily short period of time, designed in 12 weeks and then built in 40 weeks. And again, very much a soft spot in our portfolio. And I think it shows to me that projects which can happen really fast are often the best projects. If they have a clear initial idea, there's no time to lose your way or for the idea to become diluted. And so 2006 brought us what I like to describe as into the big sandpit. And we won with Wilson Architects, a firm from Brisbane who are laboratory experts, a competition at the University of New South Wales for the Lahz Cancer Research Centre. So this was the beginning of an 8-year relationship with the university as well as Wilson Architects, as well as Lendlease. So in the background was Tanorama Kiosk, another slow burner, in many ways probably death by council, but ultimately it does make our top 13 projects. Helensvale Library then came along, again a bit of a, well, not a step up in scale to Lowy, I suppose, but a fairly significant public building by virtue of the breadth of its public program being library and CCYC. We worked with a firm on the Gold Coast, Complete Urban, but more to the point, actually, we had a very much co-collaborator in the librarian who was an absolute champion. And with her, we worked to push the boundaries and explore what a library in the 21st century could be. And I think very much that is a great example of how important having switched on and progressive clients are. So back to the campus, 2014, we finished the second stage of the Lowy competition, which was the Wallaceworth redevelopment for UNSW Medicine. And I think my take out from that, for everyone who is going to work for a larger practice, is that 8 years is a big chunk of time to spend on, you know, one section of the campus. So moving to more recent work, it's Bowen Place Crossing, a project, aside from having to go on hold because the budget had to be redirected to replacing the bolts in the Shrivener Dam, in all other aspects, process, budget, client, site, clarity of ideas and detail, this is a bit of a once in a lifetime, or at least once in 20 years, winner for the office. I hope another project goes as well as this one. And then finally, another slow burner, and yet another council, this time the City of Sydney, the Heffron Hall refurbishment, which I'd have to categorise this as a labour of love. And it was really as difficult and hard as Bowen Place was easy. So a bit of a testament to my partner, Andrew Nimmo, and Andrew Lamont, who kept the course for 5 years, albeit I think Andrew jumped ship. And so often forgotten, I think, you know, it's not just about buildings, there's all the clients. And it's great thinking about clients and going back through our photos to actually see all the people we haven't really met, but who use our buildings and public places all the time, from libraries to the volunteers at the Olympics to people at the Australia Day celebrations, and skateboarders, recently Clarence, the Tiger, scientists, etc. So it's very interesting reflecting back on them. So going back to Andrew's essay. So all architecture projects need to have a basis in something, and this something can be anything, anything that draws together a coherent narrative rooted in the project. It does not need to be particularly literal or readily understood by others at a glance, but should have a sense of rigour to guide decision making. For us, this means each project grows from two specific dialogues with the client and the site. This slide shows one of the graphic illustrations. I'll probably keep forgetting to mention them, by Rowan. And the theme here was talking about dialogue, and you took our Tamarama, the two buildings in our Tamarama park, and which are lined up against cliff faces, and he shows them here having little conversation bubbles and conversations across the park. So everything has to have something, even Kellyville has to have something. So that's the site, and I know it's supposed to be a dialogue with the site, but there really wasn't that much to go on here. And our client was Blacktown City Council, and we were doing a new NRL facility for the little tackers at Kellyville. So everything needs to have something, so we worked pretty hard to work out what we could do. Modest project, modest budget, so we went to the core of the client and extracted some structural systems, some logic of laces and socks to create something that wouldn't immediately be recognisable, but for us made the project quite fun and interesting. Okay. So now I'm just going to go through some recurring themes that were found with all the navel gazing and having done our retrospective. The first one is the figurative. This is not to be taken literally. The figurative in architecture is intended as a point of departure. It allows us to explore abstract forms, motifs outside the traditional language of architecture. It also introduces something abstracted from the everyday. Architecture is a balance between the pragmatic and the conceptual. In one sense, it provides a backdrop to the everyday activities of living. On another level, architecture should provide us with uplifting moments for singular experiences. So I started here with the Royal East, the show, where we built a language around a scaffolding, skeleton, a graphic scheme, an illuminated crest and crown, and a variety of geometric clothes that we put onto all the fencing. Each tower had a little intricate theme that told you a little bit about the site. The whole overlay was whilst the City Olympic Park was being built, and the Royal East, the show, was moving out there for the first time. So ostensibly it was a construction site. And you could see various things like how many nuts held up the stadium roof. Fun facts. We extended that kind of idea of these temporary, ephemeral attention seeking forms to the so-called Olympics, and that's one of our clubbing towers. The figurative was taken even to the extent of naming the tower the clubby, because that's the nickname for lifeguards on their towers. So this one, instead of having scaffold, had a timber truss, like a roof truss frame. It had a taut translucent skin, had a little headdress there, Olympic headdress, and it was actually occupied, that was really nice. So it had the helpful little volunteers down the bottom, and then it had a little book out post at the top. A bit more of an abstract example, figurative. So here with Lowy's conceptual drawings, I suppose the narrative came from several different analyses. The first being just looking at the function of a laboratory, the rigor of having this very disciplined laboratory box, and then another piece of space that was a lot more malleable, where researchers had their workstations, amenities, collaborative areas. And then the lower diagram, looking at it from the point of view of site, where this more malleable strand is actually shaped as it moves around some of the existing landscape on the site, albeit it did get bigger and some of it got removed, but still, it started out. And then Rowan's take on Lowy, which the upper illustration are kind of grafting to the site, and then the lower one, I'm not quite sure about it, but he put it to me that it was a gun shooting cancer cells, but I'm not 100% on that, but it's a very nice little graphic. And just a couple of images just showing that those ideas, the kind of rigor of the precast concrete box, and then this green kind of collaborative strand that snakes its way out to High Street, has forms the actual atrium collaborative space inside, and then to the garden side of the building, you can see how it's shaped and wraps around the existing landscape. So onto assemblage, another one of Rowan's illustrations, this one looking at Armory Wharf Cafe. So the nature of materials and assemblage has always been an important part of the expression of our work. It allows us to explore surfaces, solidity, translucence, texture, colour, and weathering in their relationship to structure, joints, and fixings. Understanding the nature of materials leads to an understanding of their origins and appropriate methods for fabrication and the craft of building. We often think about a detail from both ends of scale, simultaneously preparing large scale plans and small scale details. The details can help to explain much about the design intent of the whole, as they capture subtleties often missing in the macro. So there's a detail of our custom detail brought in skin for Armory Wharf, which we worked closely with the builder prototyping before we went into construction. Wallaceworth, very much looking at precast, very fine feathered precast bins which peel away from the facade to reveal a kind of glossier glass facade behind. And Helen's Vow, looking at bricks, the interplay between glazed bricks and then a gold composite panel skin behind, which denotes areas of habitation. And a more detailed example provided by Heffron Hall. You can see Heffron Hall sits on Burton Street in Darlinghurst. To the rear, to the north, is a small park reserve. So just looking at the things that, I suppose, about the site, and some of the things that generated the idea from the street, Burton Street, you can see that the building is particularly solid. It's got a lower ground because the ground falls away, which you can see in this image here, has quite a beautiful sandstone wall, but from the street, you're not aware of it. From the park side, the ground steeply drops away, and you can see a fairly solid building, concrete frame with brick infill. So from that, we extracted a couple of ideas. The first was creating like a continuous terrain, opening up the view from Burton Street down through into the park, so you had an idea of a connection through from the tabernacle. The other idea was adaptive reuse, was stripping back all the infill of brick and various additions over the years and taking the building right back to its concrete frame. So as a starting point. So again, prototyping was incredibly important. The thing I forgot to mention here was after having stripped back to this concrete frame, the ideal deal was then to put like a veil on top of the canopy, and that veil would then respond to what was happening within the building as well as orientation. So that element, the veil, looking at that, we looked at using different coloured anodized panels and battens and designing a skin where it could be solid and then the battens could slide off in different densities to become a screen. And the City of Sydney being the City of Sydney, we made a one-to-one model. As much for them to see what it would look like in real scale, as well as for us to test in sunlight in different conditions how the colours worked. So there I think you can see, is that really dark? From the park then you can see quite clearly the idea of this veil, which is on a steel frame that sits proud of the building, white of the concrete frame, clearly reading through, and then a timber infill at the base, which actually has after-school care, and then moving into a series of brick walls. To the street, the veil becomes quite solid and stops to reveal this very glossy glass facade that allows quite good transparent views down into the space, but also has this quite nice reflectivity of reflecting the tabernacle on the other side of the road as well as the landscape. Moving around the corner again, the veil begins to close down and then finishes with a pop-out that shows the activities happening in the building. So from the anodized panel moving to the sandstone, so this is what the sandstone looked like when it was the building was demolished. So the first step was actually cleaning all the sandstone in situ, which I was surprised to have to be cleaned in situ, but that apparently is the best way. And then a specialist coming along and colour coding all the different pieces as to what their state of disrepair was and what could be retained and reused. And then again, I was pretty surprised, we dismantled the whole of the sandstone wall. And then we had to put in a retaining wall and then put the whole sandstone wall back. And so that's what it ended up looking like. This space is quite interesting because it shows that connection from Burton Street looking down and through the after school care to the reserve beyond. It also starts to show, just going back to that, just that idea of play, and that we worked with, as well as the City of Sydney, some artists, Jennifer Turpin and Michaela Lee Crawford, who were given a brief and a space and to an open brief to design something. They came up with a project called Swing, which is great. So it's essentially a 3D coloured pendulum that the red stick there, the kids or whoever, can pull, and that will basically generate the pendulum swinging. So a passerby on the street suddenly has this sense of movement and fun and something below. So at night time, the pendulum moving and full swing. So just finishing on about assemblage, the collection of material that we're working with. So the tinted space is proposed centers. Provided you are protected from summer, sun and rain, the benign east coast climate of Australia, allows you to be relatively comfortable in semi-outdoors environment, supplemented by a jumper in winter and a cool drink in summer. You can inhabit these spaces for most of the year. We've explored these spaces, which are not entirely outside and not entirely inside, consistently in our work. Less formal and loosely programmed, and often at the building threshold or entry, they are also social spaces. It is in these gently tempered transition spaces that the sensory aspect of architecture really comes alive. I'm going to focus on our library, Helen's Vale, which is situated on the Gold Coast in Queensland and is situated in Car Park, which is actually quite Gold Coast and quite Brisbane. So it sits in a very harsh environment. You can see the car park and also a supermarket. It has three major sections, a linear section that goes along a very busy road that houses all of the CCYC activities, performance, 3D printing, recording studios and so forth. And then on the other side, the library. You can see quite clearly there the space that we call the neighborhood room, and it actually opens out then into this plaza space that basically acts as an extension to that activity room. So as you move around the building, you have a more solid brick form, where I suppose the activities are more passive, and also a noise barrier to the road. And as you move around to the car park, the building becomes, I suppose, lightweight, but a lot more, wouldn't say defensive, but closed down. But then as you move around into this public space, the building begins to open out and reveal this large neighborhood room. So those doors are fully optical. And then you enter this space around which all the activities of the building occur. And in terms of how we made the space, the roof is like a cellular damp-along polycarbonate, and under which we've got very fine, also polycarbonate fins. So the whole thing has got this very nice glowing effect, both during the daytime, and then that is supplemented with large, the big ass fans, which you kind of see at Bunnings, very large scale. And so the neighbourhood room has really been embraced by the community. They have Christmas functions there. There's, on the different levels, people spilling out from the auditorium, people entering the library. On the upper level balcony is usually where the teenagers hang out and play their computer games. So it really becomes quite an inclusive space from very old to very young. And that's probably the best building opening I've ever been to. That was fantastic. That was the mayor opening it, and everyone then just stormed up into the library. Awesome. I'm getting to the end. So observation. As a practice, we have always been interested in how people use and respond to built environment, and how the built environment can influence how people interact. Buildings and the spaces in and around them are dynamic three-dimensional environments. We can admire the physical beauty and craftsmanship of architecture, but it is not until it is inhabited by people that it becomes meaningful. You might notice that most of our photos have people in them. We learn so much about how architecture works through observation and analysis of how people interact with architecture, and this includes both the design and the accidental. It's this kind of empirical research which looks beyond the accepted wisdom that can lead to genuine innovation in design. And I'm just providing our main library at UNSW as an example. We've had the privilege of working on this particular brutalist building for over 16 years. And so with a very, again, progressive client, we've been able to test many different ideas and have had the luxury to observe, to see how students can use space, destroy space, use things in unanticipated ways, which has been finish on mutual benefit, which was Rowan doing this with Helen's mail. As the practice has progressed, its work has grown in scale and complexity. The projects are now predominantly public and institutional. This reflects our interest in the public over the private and the humanising potential of architecture as part of a civilised community. There is an added responsibility when designing public buildings and spaces, as we are often designing for users that have no voice, users who we will never meet. Architecture is a very public art form. Everyone shares an architecture. Even a private house will address a public street. So there is an implied social contract for all architecture that it benefits not just the instigator and users of the building, but future users and anyone who comes in contact with it. Contact could be using it, visiting, occupying a neighbouring space, or simply passing as a part of your daily routine. The impact of architecture does not end at the site boundary. So just two examples, I suppose, of this. One, Bowen Place Crossing, which is a very simple, functional piece of infrastructure which provides a pedestrian and cycle underpass. And one of the reasons it's been, I think, so well received by the public is not just its functionality, but the experience it provides as they're just going about their basic jogging or cycling routine. And the other interesting thing about this is that you kind of you focus on the thing as an object, sculptural object, but then as soon as the kind of members of the public come by and start to use it, I think the architecture fades to a backdrop. So no matter how you're using it, whether you're walking or cycling, or as in the case of Canberra, there's a lot of segways, everyone gets to have a different... No, seriously, though, it's just the... Actually, when the jury came, we wanted to get a segway so they could all go down, but we couldn't get it organised. So I'll finish with the Tamarara. And again, it's got a very functional role, public showers and amenities, a commercial kiosk and some storage for the lifesavers. But its impact as an activator and theatrical backdrop to the daily spectacle of Tamarama Beach is one of its primary contributions. So there it's early morning and it's all shut up. And then as people come and the building opens up, it becomes more people who are really the theatre, and the building becomes more and more a backdrop. And just simple things like creating the basins as a kind of font in the middle of a communal space with communal outdoor showers which are open to the cliff face behind, that then become this endless kind of scene of different people doing different things, always animating and changing how you perceive the space. Okay, so moving forward, just two more slides. So, into the future, what are we doing? This is a project where we're working with Aspect Landscape. We do a lot of work with landscape designers. It's fun. And this is the redevelopment of ANU campus in Canberra, where they're redeveloping the a new campus square or centre with a series of buildings around them. We pitched for this with Aspect as a, against my philosophy, a kind of speculative competition, got shortlisted. And in terms of getting work as a small practice, we specifically targeted the public domain. All the buildings were up for grabs, all on the one by BDM. So we knew we were never really going to have a shot at that. And it's actually been quite, shame Sue Ann isn't here, it's been quite informative being on the other side. That's right. Because the public domain keeps on getting squeezed and privatised and has all the budget taken out of it. Yeah. The other thing, and we're also working with Aspect on this, is for the Sydney Harbour Trust, which is the redevelopment of the HMAS fake.